Hello everyone, this is Dr. Radhika from Salimani Center for Ornithology and Natural History, India. I'm also an honorary researcher at UKZN under Prof. Downs. This gives a general background of how climate and land cover change act as strong global forces on the range ecology of forest obligatory birds through changes in rooting phenology, diseases, and habitat loss. Now, often forest obligates face high extinction rates in forest fragments, which are transforming over time. Fluctuations in precipitation influence plant phenology, affecting the availability of fruits for frugivores. Yet, tropical birds overcome these food shortages by exploiting high quality resourceful patches or by shifting their diet to replenish the energy lost for apparent survival and fitness. Now, whatever may be their strategy for survival, dispersal processes in and out of forest patches can drive spatiotemporal occupancy of birds through emigration and immigration, where populations become locally extinct in some sites and colonize new sites in different time frames. The Cape parrot is South Africa's only endemic parrot, vulnerable on the IUCN Red List of Threatened Species. Within South Africa, it is endangered according to the 2015 ESCOM Red Data List. They are patchily distributed in the fragmented southern and northern misbelt forest fragments in KZN, Eastern Cape and Limpopo provinces. They prefer high altitudes between 700 and 1,500 meters above sea level where they are resident, but also visit the forests along the warm east coast of KZN and Eastern Cape. The current Cape parrot population consists of three genetically distinct subpopulations: southern group in the Amatole Mountains in the Eastern Cape, the central group from Nkobo and Mtata in the Eastern Cape through to the Midlands in KZN, and a disjunct northern population, mainly in the Magowa's Kloof in Limpopo province. Some of the threats faced by Cape parrots include the fragmentation of indigenous forest patches from intense logging activity, coupled with global trade of parrot species, and climatically induced disease outbreaks such as the Citizen beak and feather virus, which has been infecting a lot of captive individuals and wild populations as well. There is also growing evidence on the Podophagus shot-hole borer beetle, which has been infecting almost 43% of Cape parrot feeding tree species. Increased plantations around indigenous forest patches are some of the threats faced by the Cape parrot. Now, the major objective of the study is to assess 13 years of colonization and extinction dynamics of Cape parrot as a function of resource distribution and climate and land cover change along its range. We had two a priori predictions. We predicted that warm temperatures and area covered by orchards influenced colonization probabilities of Cape parrot, while low rainfall, patch size, and land cover change influenced extinction rates. We also expected a higher colonization probability where fruiting trees and nest sites were present and where disturbances or threats were absent. The general methodology adapts the typical citizen science surveys done globally. We first identify indigenous forest patches along the Cape parrot's range. Interviews of landowners, conservancies, and conservation managers were conducted directly and through social media platform. The event was called as a Cape Parrot Big Birding Day, which involves visits to these indigenous forest patches for 2 days by large groups of volunteers, which are coordinated by a team leader. 3 hours before sunset on the first day, and we follow 3 to 5 hours from sunrise on the second day, usually in April, May, which is in the autumn season. Visits were made inside and outside forest patches of varying sizes. ownership and other budgeting disturbances. Important data such as the presence absence of Cape Parrot, the flock size, GPS coordinates, roosting activity, feeding, drinking, breeding, direction of flight, disturbances, and search effort were recorded by each observer. Now, all this data was then put on a GIS platform, and 5x5 kilometer grid cells were overlaid, covering all the survey points. And then grid-wise presence-absence data was modeled with multi-season occupancy models in program unmarked in program R using package unmarked. So we had a total of 186 sampled grid cells for which detection histories were created for the analysis. Pyramidal covariates varied from patch size, temperature, precipitation, land cover loss and gain, latitude, density of invasive plant species, presence absence of pecan nut trees, yellowwood trees, observer effort, and various types of disturbances like logging and presence of predators. So our model results show that there are two top models with a high ACAC weight of more than 0.7. If we sum up the two top models, the presence absence of pecan trees, area of water bodies and patch size influenced initial occupancy in the both the models. Temperature, nest site presence, yellowwood tree presence, area of orchards influenced colonization probability, precipitation, patch size, area of indigenous forest, area of urbanization and plantation, as well as water bodies influenced extinction probabilities, while year was an important detection covariate in both the top models. And then averages of the predicted outputs were then plotted against top variables. So the initial occupancy, as you can see, did not vary much across years, while detection rates increased from 2007 onwards. As temperatures increased, the colonization rates also increased, and the same relationship was found between increase in area of orchards and colonization probabilities. Colonization probability also increased in nest sites and yellowwood, wherever yellowwood trees were present. While extinction probabilities were higher where precipitation was low, which is roughly about 40 millimeters, and extinction rates were higher in small patch sizes, like about 227 hectares of forest patch. Occupancy probabilities fluctuated with environmental variability across years at the provincial level, showing regional expansion and contraction, while it remained relatively stable in some sites. Occupancy of Cape Parrot seems to be increasing in the former Transkei in recent years, suggesting that the range shift is appearing southeastwards from 2010 to 2014. Extinction rates increased in specific years, suggesting that the spatiotemporal distribution of Cape Parrot was strongly influenced by regional and annual changes in precipitation, especially in recent years. Cape Parrots went locally extinct from forest patch complexes and colonized new sites, largely in the former Transkei regions and the demesne of the Eastern Cape, including the scarp forests along the coast. Our dynamic occupancy modeling approach is the first to be applied to understand the long-term range dynamics of a food nomadic bird. Our results contradict the traditional view that only forested patches support high occupancies of forest specialists, as even sites in the land use matrix had high colonization rates. These newly colonized sites at various time frames are attributed to the absence of food in indigenous forests, as the fruiting of their preferred trees, that is the yellowwood trees, have become sporadic, and sometimes fruiting is even absent in some years. Only 30% of the sites along the species range have gained indigenous forest cover as a result of the ongoing restoration activity, and 54% of the range has increased plantation cover. Now, an important strategy to stimulate Cape Parrot population growth would be by protecting the existing natural nests in yellowwood forests and the remaining indigenous forest fragments along the range. Conservation efforts must prioritize the protection of patches with high colonization rates and manage the intervening landscape between patches to enhance the survival probabilities of the bird. In recent years, the maps have shown the flow of their range shifts more southeastwards in Limpopo, towards the coast and inland in the former Transkei. Thus, the Cape Parrot's range will probably continue along these routes in the near future, like other nomadic birds of South Africa. Lastly, I would like to thank the University of KwaZulu-Natal for supporting my postdoctoral fellowship. The National Research Foundation is thanked for supporting the Cape Parrot project, as well as the Wild Bird Trust has been continuously supporting this citizen science initiative for more than 10 years. Thank you.